Welcome to this policy exchange event on changing the culture of philanthropy. Thank you very much for coming. We'd also particularly like to thank JP Morgan for hosting us this evening in these lush surroundings. And to start us off, I'd like to encourage Paul Knox from JP Morgan to say a few words.
Thank you very much, Neil. Yes, my name's Paul Knox. I'm a managing director at JP Morgan in the private bank. We're very pleased to be hosting this event for the policy exchange tonight. The whole issue around promoting debate around philanthropy is something that is very dear to our hearts. And we think that particularly at this stage, it's very critical that this is something which is publicly aired. At JP Morgan, philanthropy is central to much of what we do. As a bank, we give away over $150 million a year. And in the private bank, we now have Rebecca Eastman, who's one of the speakers tonight, who is actively advising our client base on philanthropic giving and the strategy around giving. And I mean, the whole issue of philanthropy giving and the need for it in the current environment was forcibly brought home to me today. I managed to help in procuring what I thought was a relatively small and modest amount of money for an outfit in North London, that, and this was to help finance some sporting events for disabled children. And I was speaking to the person from the borough of Haringey, who said, you know, if this money hadn't come forward, then this, which was a project that had been running for a number of years, simply wouldn't have happened. So I think, you know, in the current economic climate, it is really important that we find ways to encourage charitable giving. So the only other thing that I've been asked to do tonight is some of the house points, which is really around fire alarms. And I must admit, this note that I've been asked to read out has been intriguing me all day, because it says that in the event that an alarm or detector is activated, you will hear a pre-tone sounding like a slow whoop. I've got no idea what a pre-tone sounding like a slow whoop sounds like. I'm certainly not going to try and do an impression of one. But if you hear a strange sound and wonder if that is a slow whoop, what will then happen is that there will be a pre-recorded announcement advising us to leave the building. So that will clear the situation for you. And if that happens, then everything is clearly signposted. So anyway, I will hand you back to Neil, but I hope you have a very nice evening. And on behalf of JP Morgan again, we're delighted that you're all here tonight.
Thank you, Paul. As Paul said, this is, in a sense, a very important moment for us to be meeting. We have a period where, as Nick Clegg was reminding us all today, public budgets are under huge pressure and likely to remain so for a long time to come. And yet at the same time, the government, under the rubric of the big society, is extremely keen to encourage more giving, more philanthropy and more charitable activity. It's a good moment also because we've come back after the end of summer, and the summer started, of course, with two extremely important and meaty contributions to this discussion. Firstly, the Giving White Paper in May, and then secondly, the Independent Philanthropy Review, which came out in June, and we're delighted to have lots of the key people involved in producing those two pieces of work, both on the platform and also, I know, in the audience. This is a huge topic, absolutely vast one. Some of the things that I hope we might talk about here this evening include who does what, and this is really about what is the right role for government, for the charities themselves, but for other organisations like schools and businesses and professional advisors in encouraging and changing the culture of philanthropy. We're keen to talk about the relationship with volunteering in philanthropy. Some people give their time and end up giving their money, some people vice versa. Keen to talk about the financial framework, which we always like talking about, the role of particularly new things like living legacies and the current mix of tax incentives. Interested in the new innovations in giving too, so for example, charity bank accounts or payroll giving or blended funding and new things like the Big Society Bank, which I know Gareth is involved with. And lastly, but absolutely not leastly, as a think tank, one of the things we do at Policy Exchange is always to think about how other countries do things and whether there's anything we can learn from them. So very interested in talking about whether there are important differences we can learn from. People always talk about the US in comparison to the UK, but of course there are lots of other countries around Europe we could potentially learn from too. Now, to have this discussion, we are extremely blessed to have a panel that is not just experienced and knowledgeable, but also comes from an interesting and a wide range of different perspectives. It's also a sort of a proof of the old saying that, you know, if you want to, you want something doing, ask a busy person. Because I look at your CVs, our panelists are immersed in so many different charities and good works that it's difficult to know when to start. So in very brief form, We're going to start with Robin, Lord Janvrin, who is currently Deputy Chairman of HSBC. He was previously Private Secretary to the Queen and also had a very successful diplomatic career. We're then going to hand over to Richard Castle. He is currently a partner at Withers Worldwide. He's a top legal advisor, particularly on trusts and cross-border activity. He's been a key mover in the push for lifetime legacies, which I think he's talking to the Treasury about at the moment. And he's also a trustee of the European Association of Philanthropy and Giving, so he knows a lot about the international context. Rebecca Eastmond is the UK head of philanthropic services at JP Morgan. She was the founder and CEO of the Prince's Foundation for Children and the Arts, and is also involved in Teach First, so she can give us a kind of an advisor's perspective. And Gareth Davies has had an incredibly successful career in both the public and private sectors. He was a senior policy advisor in Downing Street. He then ran the strategy unit, and he's currently running the Office for Civil Society, and before that he was in the private sector. And lastly, but absolutely not leastly, Tom Hughes-Hallett was the chairman of the recent Philanthropy Review. He's been chief executive of Marie Curie Cancer Care since 2000, and he's involved in so many different charities. I'm not going to read them all out. They involve Great Ormond Street or the King's Fund and many, many other things besides. So we have an hour for this discussion. I hope that it will be a true discussion. We're going to have some initial thoughts from our panelists to kick us off and get the discussion going, and then we're going to open out for Q&A, and I'm going to aim to wrap up in about an hour's time. So without any further ado, it's a great pleasure to be able to hand over to Lord Janvrin. Thank you very much.
Neil, thank you very much. And can I thank Policy Exchange as well as JP Morgan for the opportunity of tonight. I think it is important to debate this subject. It has risen inexorably up the political agenda in recent months, indeed, I would say in the last few years. And one can measure that in not only the reports, the books, etc., but the number of gatherings like this, where we're basically addressing the question, how do we change the culture of giving in this country? Or as the Philanthropy Review had it, to encourage more people to give and people to give more. I wanted to, by way of introduction, to set the scene with a few statistics, but I think they point to why I think it's worth sitting around here tonight and looking at this this issue. Can I say, by way of focus, that we might be talking about corporate giving, mass giving campaigns, giving time, not money, but I think we're talking mainly about what I would call personal giving, individual giving, major donor giving, that sort of end of the spectrum. All the others are very important, very valid, etc. But I think in debating this subject and looking at the policy and what we might do, we're looking at the donor giving money. And I would start simply by the fact that we are a generous nation. I think that we need to recognise this, and we need to look for ways of recognising it. It's part of our history. One only has to think of words like Shaftesbury, Barnardo, Peabody, Roundtree to know that this was in the DNA of this country 100 years ago, 150 years ago, the Victorian age in particular. If one wants other measures, 56% of the population give. We're second after the US in some of the comparisons of internationally. Help for Heroes, a charity close to my heart, because I've had a son in the services, has raised £109 million. Two people, a married couple, sat down in October 2007 and said we must do something about this. And the figure at the moment is 109 million and counting. Comic Relief, Red Nose Day, last one, according to their website, which I checked today, stands at 102 million, the last Red Nose Day. Really incredible amounts of money are raised in this country. The estimate is 10.6 billion per year. Now, how accurate that is, I just don't know. But I think we need to keep in mind that we are a generous nation. But equally, I think we need to bear in mind that we could do more. the rise in giving over the past two decades has roughly been in line with GDP growth. 0.4% of total household spending is philanthropic. That's quite a pretty small figure. 8% of donors give 47% of total donations. The poorest 10% of donors give proportionally more than the richest 10% of donors. 9% only of legacies go to charity. These are actually quite low figures. So we may be a generous nation, but it is reasonable to say that we probably could do more. And I think it goes without saying, and Neil has said so, you could say that at the present time, there's never been a more important time to look at this. Charitable giving can in no way replace government funding. But the point that I would make is that private giving allows the kind of charitable activities which the government often can't do, the risky, innovative, at the edge kind of activities. There's just been a very good, I'm looking around to see Emma, she's not here, Emma Turner. There's been a New Philanthropy Capital Barclays study making this very point that very often it's the private donor who can give money to do quite edgy things in the charitable sector. So there are lots of good reasons why we need to focus on whether we can give more. And I want to leave it to my colleagues to explore some of the ways of doing this. I would make two very general points. One is, I don't think we should simply say we need to be like the Americans. I don't think we have that culture, history, background. They start from a completely different point, in my view. We can learn from them. We can learn lots from the way they do things. But we've got to develop our own British culture of giving. And the second point is that there's no magic bullet. And Neil's mentioned this. Government are involved. Corporations are involved. The corporate world. Charities need to think of how they can change the culture. Donors, certainly. The use of technology. The media. All these players have got a stake in how we change the culture.
Extremely good, thank you. Robin, thank you. The interesting point to end on, that we can borrow ideas, but we can't necessarily borrow situations. And I know, Richard, you were planning to talk about some of the ideas that we can bring in from other countries.
Thank you very much. I do want to say that I don't think we should become like the Americans, but I don't see any harm in trying to steal some of their good ideas and use them ourselves and adapt them into the UK system, which is what the Living or Lifetime Legacies campaign that's been that EAPG has been very active in promulgating is all about. What is it? It's not a technique. It's a technique that fits quite well into the UK tax and regulatory system, and it doesn't involve a lot of new tax reliefs. It's really a question of aligning the existing tax reliefs. It's not going to involve significant changes in our legislative framework for charitable giving. But we believe it is a tool that, if we offer this into the charitable sector here, could have a similar effect to that, to the way it's used in the United States. I've had some people say that it's just a fancy planning mechanism for the rich. That's not how it works in the United States. Sure, rich people can use it, just as rich people make cash gifts. But it is also very much a tool that uses very standard documents and is used by the mass affluent, the comfortable professionals, people who've got who may be on the point of retiring or having retired, find that they've got some surplus assets that they would like to apply towards charitable giving, but they don't quite want to part completely with possession of the assets. So the key to this is that the donor gives away the asset, or the cash, but receives back a pension and income, which can be set at a level agreed between the donor and the charity, and therefore can supplement a donor's pension or can replace a salary income or something like that. And in many cases in the United States, people do that because they're nervous that they won't have quite enough income to live on if they give away a significant amount of cash. But in fact, they often end up foregoing the income, giving the income stream back to the charity as well. The charity, it's much better than a legacy for a charity. Why? Because it's an irrevocable gift. It's not a promise, oh yes, sure, I'll remember you in my will. It means that the charity knows it is an irrevocable gift and they can see the money now. It means that the charity can acknowledge the gift during the donor's lifetime. This is tremendously important. It means the charity can build up a much stronger relationship with the donor and put, you can have a brass plate on the wall of your charity or institution or whatever it is. You can do whatever it is the charity can do to encourage the donor to feel part and involved with the charity. And it means that the charity knows, in planning for the future, they know that there will be funds coming in, and if the charity is fortunate enough to develop a reasonable program of remainder trusts, or lifetime legacy gifts, they can plan for future capital development funding. I thought the best thing would be is if I just take you through the flowchart of what is it. I'm happy to discuss at any length you want exactly some of the technical issues, but basically the key is you have to have a trust document because that's what keeps everybody honest. That's what makes the donor put the money, and the donor knows that he or she is going to receive back the income, and the charity knows it's going to get the money at the end of the day. So there is an irrevocable gift. People have said, well, what's the minimum amount? I would think, but much below £10,000, and it's not worth doing. But so we're looking at gifts of probably over £10,000. You have to have a trustee. The trustee could be a charity. We've been discussing with people involved with this. I think that we think it should be somebody who's at least, if it's not the charity, if it should be somebody who's an authorised professional charity, a professional trustee, I mean. Or somebody authorised by the Charity Commission. The funds transferred into the lifetime legacy then needs to be exempt from CGT and inheritance tax. Those are the two tax changes that we need. And we're replicating the same situation as a legacy. Because if you leave a legacy to charity, there's no CGT and there's no inheritance tax. We would like to suggest looking across the Atlantic at the US that there should be some income tax relief for a discounted value of the gift. You shouldn't receive an entire income tax relief for the entire gift because remember the donor's keeping back an income stream. So it would have to be, but you can simply use annuity tables. It's not a very complicated thing to do. Then during the lifetime, the capital is held in trust and the income goes to the donor, on which the donor has to pay income tax. But it does mean that the charity can, if it's planning a major development, for example, it can use it as security for a borrowing. And obviously when the donor dies or at the end of a term of years, sometimes people want to do it for a five-year term because maybe they want to fill in a gap in their income until a pension kicks in or something like that. At the end of whatever the term is agreed, the capital all goes to the charity. And that should be free from tax. So that is it in essence. Who benefits from it? Well, in particular, as you would expect in the United States, the experience is that it is charitable organizations that develop strong links with donors. So the higher education sector is particularly strong for them because Americans are very generous to their colleges and universities. In the healthcare area, hospitals and other healthcare medical related things, and cultural museums, arts organizations. I would say I've seen some people say, well, this could be used for gifts of works of art. It's in fact not very good for gifts of works of art for some technical reasons. And I believe that to try to fit them into that box is going to complicate things. So I'm not. I would prefer not to try to fit them into that box. And it has now forms a major part of fundraising for example, universities in the United States. In this country, we are moving away from complete state funding of our universities. We're charging fees. Universities need to raise endowments so they can grant bursaries and scholarship funding. This is a perfect way to achieve that type of long-term funding. I think I've gone over my allotted time, Neil, so I'll stop there, but happy to talk about it during the Q&A.
Thank you, Richard. Now, Rebecca, you've had both the kind of the doers and the advisors' perspective on all these things. What do you make of all this?
So in my day job, I work with clients in JP Morgan Private Bank on their giving, individuals and family foundations. It was also a privilege to sit on the board of the Philanthropy Review with Tom, so I kind of come with those two hats. As my experiences in working with our private clients, I'll restrict most of my observations to this narrow but important segment of potential and actual philanthropists, but I think it's really important to reiterate Robin's point that Britain is a generous nation and we really need not beat ourselves up about our giving too much. I think you said in 09-10 alone, individuals in the UK gave just under 11 billion to charity, a further 2 billion from trusts and foundations, another 2 billion from corporates. We are one of the most generous nations in the world. As a percentage of GDP, we give four times as much as the French, three times as much as the Germans, and 1.5 times as much as the Dutch. The Americans do give more, but if you take out giving to universities and religious organisations, we get a lot closer. And as my friend Caroline, who's sat in the back, I can see her, said to me the other day, when you drive around America, you see those signs by the side of the highway. So this segment of the highway is sponsored by the local Rotary Club. If we were forced to do our highway maintenance by way of private philanthropy rather than taxes, we might get a little bit closer again to the Americans. So there is something about the way that we divide up our public and private sector work that makes us different. And I think that applies not just to the US, UK, but around Europe and around the rest of the world. Nevertheless, the fact is that the proportion of households who give to charity is less now than it was 30 years ago. And that has got to be wrong. People earning over £100,000 give a smaller percentage of their income than those below. The richest 10% give just over 1% of their income, whereas the poorest 10%, as you said, give 3.5%, 3.4%. And of the very richest, those with more than £20 million to their name, who are the people I tend to talk to, only 17% give at all. There is something about why that is and, you know, not dipping into capital and all that kind of stuff, but it really does need to change. I would also say, so my kind of two points are, giving is great and giving well is so much better. The difference between straightforward giving away money and engaged in strategic philanthropy can be huge in terms of what it achieves. And it's addictive. If you engage your head as well as your heart in your giving, you will see results and then you will want to do more. And there is something about charities reaching out to donors, but there's a lot more about donors reaching out to charities. I can bang on about that for a long time and I hope you'll ask me questions on the topic. A second related point is that philanthropy, although by definition expressing someone's personal values and motivations, is a team sport. You get nowhere in giving if you work alone. By definition, a philanthropist needs to work at least with a charity and a social entrepreneur. To work well, you will need partners, individuals, foundations, public sector bodies, and I think the role of government in working with individuals and foundations is extremely important. Collaboration is the key to achieving change at any level. Couple of examples. Those involved in financing and running the campaign to end the slave trade. The Society for the Abolition of the Slave Trade was founded in 1787. Everyone remembers the contribution of Wilberforce, but many thousands of individual men and women joined the campaign. They ran local groups, they raised funds, they distributed pamphlets, and they worked collectively for decades. And we finally abolished slavery in 1833. It was a long road, but it was a collective vision. Also, if you look at the response to the 1984, to Michael Burke's appeal in 1984 to the news coverage of the Ethiopia famine, and that led to Live Aid, indirectly to Commie Relief, Live Aid, Make Poverty History, and the Jubilee Debt Campaign, and that has resulted in billions of pounds of unpaid debt being cancelled. Friends of mine who live in the US now have dedicated much of their lives and a large part of their significant fortune to working in rural Ethiopia. It goes back to standing in Live Aid. Do you think that Bill and Melinda Gates work alone? Absolutely not. They work with public and private sector partners. They work with DFID in the UK, researchers, governments, NGOs, to try to solve the very large problems that are affecting the poorest people in the world. In this game, you can't do things on your own. So, in summary, we need to do more to celebrate our national giving. We need to galvanise support for charities at a time when they need it most. And to create real change, we need to create and support mechanisms that support both smart giving and collaboration at every level.
So Rebecca talks about being able to work with government, and interestingly, Gareth is working on all kinds of new ways for individuals to get involved with government.
Yes, thanks very much for inviting me this evening. I'll leave Thomas to take you through the details of the philanthropy review, which is absolutely excellent. And I think others here have mentioned the Giving White Paper, which talked about how the government is looking to promote giving of time and money more generally, frankly, through making it easier and more compelling. What I thought I'd focus on tonight is what I see more as a benefit of philanthropy and some of the gains. Once the money's been raised, how can we make the most from it? How can we make the most in terms of tackling some of the really embedded, deep-seated social problems the UK is facing? Robin, you mentioned the, again, excellent piece of work from New Philanthropy Capital that was published this week around some of the scale of the social problems and the size. I think that they sort of quantified them at £100 billion. Broke them into things around early intervention, mental health, and problem families. But I say it's nothing, you know, the analysts in me loved the report, thought it was really rigorous, and it was great to bring some actual context and specificity to it. There's nothing like being sort of seeing it firsthand. And I don't know what you were doing on the evening of the 8th of August. I was doing my normal commute home, happily going back to Wandsworth, and then came out about 7 o'clock into the middle of the riot zone that was Clapham Junction. And I think you can read as many reports as you like, and even live there as I have for 6 years. It only being in the middle of that sort of disturbance and the riots where you really start to see this, the real nature and the extent of the social problems we're facing in this country. I'm sure we've all got our own views and interpretations around what happened over those days in August in terms of the causes. We've got the Independent Commission. I'll be interested to see what they said. But I think it's a pretty shared view across the political spectrum now. I think shared by charities, many commentators, many people who were there, many people who were affected, that at the heart of this is a big issue around problem families. And by that, I don't mean the normal problems that all families face. I mean the real chaotic, unstructured families who had a sense of the normal bounds, limitations, connections, frankly, with the normal social norms of work, school, education, and civic society. And the writer really brought that home, certainly to me personally, but also in this, the figures around the cost of society. Successive governments have known this. Successive governments, and I think we can go back 10, 20 years, have tried to tackle it, which remained remarkably intractable, despite the best endeavours. And part of that is just frankly because of the difficulty of tackling these, you know, well, technically, you know, these wicked problems from the centre of government, from SW1. There's very little I know from looking at Whitehall about what's really going on in some communities, around what's really needed in terms of the interventions to try and tackle what's now one, two, if not three generations of social exclusion, of absence from the labour market, from some of the norms that we'd expect in our lives. There's lots of reasons for that. Partly that's just the natural way of government, and frankly some of the inefficiencies you face in any large organisation. But I think there's something quite important around the role of innovation, around trying something new. I think, Robin, you were calling some of the more edgy and difficult solutions that might be needed. The danger of civil servants, and I've been one now for 10 years, is you always worry about what the PAC will say 5 years down the track. Now, hopefully you may have moved on and you'll be okay, but frankly, there's always that chance you won't have, and you'll be pulled back in. And quite rightly, if we're spending public money, is it right to spend public money on trying things out? there's different views, but what I think the real benefit of philanthropy can be is, frankly, to try some of these big bets, to try something different and to see what works. And I think if you look at the role of problem families, these 120,000 chaotic families, there's something really interesting that philanthropists can now do to try out. They're not going to solve it. Even if your review is entirely successful and raises the additional £2 billion, that won't be enough to tackle the problem. But what it can do is try things out that, frankly, we in government, we in civil service, can't and probably shouldn't be doing. But we can learn from you. And then once we find out things that work, we can then move in at scale. And so what I'm particularly interested in the work I'm doing is trying to connect philanthropy through to social investment in terms of tackling some of these social problems. It's not my job, certainly not government's job, to try and direct philanthropy, far from it, but trying to think about how we can then use the endeavours, the focus, the grip and the control to try and tackle some of these issues. I think if you look at the work Emma Harrison, for example, is doing on problem families, it's very interesting. What I'm also trying to do now is we're trying to create some financial structures to try and get the best, frankly, bang for the buck. Over the summer, we launched a set of pilots in the Cabinet Office, social impact bonds. You're probably familiar with these, but what these are trying to do is bring together three parties. Frankly, a commissioner, someone typically at local government or central government level, who's concerned with a problem. A private or charitable body who thinks they can tackle the issue. So this could be, say, Emma Harrison in her charitable role. It could be Turning Point. And then a financier to try and fund it. What the government then pays on outcomes. So it's a combination of payment by outcomes, private or voluntary delivery, with third-party finance. Now, given if the NCP, the National the New Philanthropic Capital Report, right, and there's £100 billion of cost of these problems, these things should be self-financing. They may or they may not be. But what's needed to get these things going may be a blend of commercial and philanthropic money. And that's what I think is a really exciting opportunity over the next few years in the UK, is how we can bring together some philanthropic money, some private sector delivery, and the role of government as a convener, catalyst and a mobiliser to try new things out. We know the old ways have failed, so if we can try something different, structured properly so we can actually learn from our different experiments and then move then to scaling them up, I think that's really where we want to focus our work in the Office of Civil Society. Happy to talk about social impact bonds more generally, also the work around Big Society Bank and some of the Giving White Paper proposals in conversation.
Thank you. Very interesting. You guys talked about both the role of charity as an innovator and what it does, and also innovations in how we raise money and combine it with government money too. Tom, huge pleasure to have you here. I know you're up in the wee small hours of the morning raising lots of money, and you're doing it again this evening, so particularly grateful to have you here.
It's a pleasure. I'm going to be brief and just make, perhaps in the interest of getting to questions, I'm just going to make a few bullet points. So don't worry, I'm not going to go through a whole review. Firstly, the white paper. Great. Innovative, really helpful, and a real sign, I think, that this government is embracing charity. Best budget the charity sector's had for 10 years. So some really great signs that government's getting behind us. Secondly, but this isn't the government's problem. I completely agree with Gareth. What we've got to do is to make it easier for people to give. And if the government can help that through some fiscal incentives, so much the better. So what the review and some of my wonderful colleagues, I'm pleased to see after about 3 months here tonight, was simply to do one thing. It wasn't to make charities better at asking. It absolutely wasn't what we were trying to do. What we were trying to do was to help you to give. So we were simply trying to raise more money. Simple as that. First goal was to make it easier for people to give by making it actually part of our daily culture. That actually it's just something we all do. So we tried to find two or three vehicles that would help do that. We've already talked about one of them, which is the big, big win. If we can get lifetime legacies in, then it will make a huge difference to levels of charitable giving in this country. Secondly, payroll giving has been an utter disaster. It's been a cock-up from beginning to end. It's not well managed. I signed up a payroll giving form in May to give money to my favourite charity, which is not the one I work for, it's the one my wife runs. I have to say that, because I gather we're being recorded tonight.
Hi, darling.
I still haven't had a thank you letter from the wonderful Dress for Success. Why? Because she hasn't got the money yet. So So between the payroll giving agencies and my employer, they've been sitting on my money for 4 months. It's close to illegal. So there are some real issues that have got to be crunched here. And I think anything that government can do to help and to resolve and to innovate there would be massively welcome. But we should all give through our payroll giving. It's so easy. Two simple facts. You're giving away money you've never received because you never get it. And giving is all about psychology, actually. Mm-hmm. But if you don't get it, it doesn't hurt very much. And secondly, it is the only way you can give cash in this country and offset it fully against income tax. So just before you think it's gift aid, it isn't. You don't get to offset that. The charity gets to. And by the way, they never thank you for it. So again, the psychology of gift aid is the charity thinks the government's given it to them. So they never thank you. They thank you for the £10 you've given. The cute ones are beginning to thank you for the £12, whatever it is. But actually, it doesn't feel like it's someone. So we've got to make it. Payroll giving is essential. Do not listen to those who say they will kill themselves if people talk about payroll giving. They're wrong. This is something that's got to be taken on. Mm. Instead of by 2% of the employees in this country, it's got to become motherhood and apple pie. And I believe it's got to be led by example here, that the chairman and chief executives, Marks and Spencers, dare I say the National Health Service, should actually be, as the largest employer in this country, should be the very first to sign up. So that's the one, first one. And the second one I'm going to mention is charity bank accounts. I'm really sorry you've fallen over and damaged your leg, Horse Bank. But well done for being the first bank to get off the blocks with a charity bank account. Every single one of us should have a deposit account, a current account, a mortgage account if we want one. We probably will have to have one. But we should have a charity account too, which attracts the same gift aid relief as a CAF account does. It is a scandal that there is a monopoly in CAF. It's not right. It's anti-competitive in my view. Every single high street bank should be pressured to pressure for that monopoly to be broken. And actually, Robin, and I know you agree with me, so I'm going to say it anyway. And my brother is on the board of HSBC, yes, so yeah, I'm going to say it again. HSBC should make available to every single one of its clients a charity bank account, full stop. It was great news when the chairman of Lloyds TSB said he was going to do it, and then his colleagues told him they couldn't afford to. I mean, I'm short-cutting, but if you look, Wim Bischoff actually saluted charity bank accounts. It's interesting to see they haven't done anything about it yet. So we want that. And if we all had one, do you know what? We'd all give, because it would just be natural. Finally, I want to tell you that we need to celebrate more, and I share so much with Rebecca this. We need to talk about it. I'm going to tell you, yesterday I gave £50,000 to charity, and I did. Why? Because that is my tax bill for the coming year. I have given it in shares. So I am acting as my own Chancellor of the Exchequer. So instead of the A130 between Haydock Park and Lingfield being sort of potholed, and I don't live anywhere near it, I'm going to give that money directly to small causes around my house in Suffolk. I'm afraid the Chancellor's going to get no money. But charity is. And so I've had the fun of being my own Chancellor of the Exchequer. And what fun. And I'm one of these rather embarrassing philanthropists in here. But in here it says, quoting me apparently, today I can't stop telling my friends how much fun it is. And do you know what? It really is. So thank you.
Brilliant stuff, Tom, and brilliant stuff, all of you. Right, we've got some time for questions and answers. If you put your hands up, and if you can also say who you are and where you're from, and we'll try and take maybe a bunch of questions. Let's start. So there's a gentleman right in the back row, and there's a microphone right next to you.
Good evening. Thank you for your fantastic contributions. My name is Musa Kwonga. I work for the Institute for Philanthropy, where we advise donors on charitable giving. A lot of fantastic schemes I've heard about here, but just looking at the numbers, about 11 billion a year, looking to raise by 2 billion, I think, but the scale of social problems is 100 billion. What that suggests is that we're looking for some kind of systemic generational change in giving. One area we should really, I think, look at is what can we do to energize young people in their philanthropy? What kind of schemes would we be looking to roll out across the board for younger people, maybe those entering the professional world, but also even before that at school?
Extremely good question. Yeah. Should we We'll just take one other question with that, and then we'll maybe we'll take two questions with it. In fact, so there's a lady at the back, and then there's a gentleman in the second row there.
Hi, I'm Caroline Fiennes. I run a charity and do a bunch of other things, and I'm very interested in effective giving, so as well as getting more giving, getting giving to be more effective. I wanted to pick up on Gareth's point about the interface between giving and government, because often the way that donors can really magnify the impact of their giving is, as Rebecca says, by working with others. And, you know, David Sainsbury talks about charity as the R&D of society. Mm-hmm. And, okay, that's fine, you do your R&D, and then what? You know, who actually rolls it out? And the answer is usually business and or government. So I just wanted to hear a little more from you, Gareth, about how that interface can work better. That having mm-hmm. worked with umpteen donors of different sizes over time, my experience is that can be quite difficult for mm-hmm. donors to get to figure out the right people in government and yeah. and for them to be focusing on issues that actually need some R&D. So I just mm-hmm. would like to explore that.
That's a very interesting question. And then the gentleman, just in a second, right at the end there.
Thanks. My name is Steve Podmore of Transform Capital Management. A reason for a lot of our malaise is basically we have some very big funding gaps in where market solutions are most appropriate. Basically, companies of 1 to 500 employees generate 80% of all jobs and 50% plus of all innovation, according to MIT and others, but we're putting way less than 1% of our institutional investment down there. So my question is basically, where do you see impact investment as being the bridge, or to bridge the gap, following on from Gareth and the point just behind, about not just the R&D of society, but taking things and taking things to scale? And where is charity not appropriate for certain activity, where the costs of marketing are too high, and where market solutions that can incentivize talent and raise capital in a sustainable fashion, where is that most appropriate?
Very good question. So who wants to pick off what first? I thought I might try and pick on Tom first to see which of those he wants to address. Particularly this point about young people, perhaps.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. I mean, I think the first thing is, rather like Robin talking about good news earlier, I mean, I think the good news is that this new generation is much more generous than mine. So I really do think that's the case. Mm. And I think that is something to do with example. You know, I think my generation I'm 57, have just begun to get it about charity, but a little bit late. Whereas I know my children really get it and really understand about their role in the local community. But I do think that when it comes to philanthropy, as opposed to smaller gifts, I think parents empowering children to be the distributors of their wealth mm-hmm. is a huge plus. And I think that wealth can be £5 or £500,000. So actually, in my own daughter's memory, I founded a charitable foundation through which I channel all my giving. I have no vote on the board. It's all given away by my 27-year-old doctor son, my 24-year-old documentary maker daughter, and PricewaterhouseCoopers' newest recruit. And it drives me bonkers. I mean, I sit there sort of longing to interfere, but I think we've got to empower these guys to really want to do it. And I'm very optimistic, by the way, and I think a lot of the stuff that was in the white paper around schools mm-hmm. and a lot of the work that Trevor Pears and the Institute of Philanthropy have been doing is of huge value. So I'm a big optimist on this. I think in 30 years, we're not going to have the problem we face today.
Mm. Robin?
Can I absolutely agree with that. That was this business of introducing philanthropy into schools in various different ways is very exciting, and some of the work being done on that. The other word I'd say in this regard is technology. I think there's some interesting things way beyond me that are being done in using technology to make giving easier. And I think I'm right in saying that on the last Comic Relief Day, £15 million was given by text. So, I mean, this is a new way that young people, I know my children get it in ways that I don't, but I just think it is so important that we move with that, we move very quickly with it to harness technology to help in this sphere.
On the point that was directed very much at you, Gareth, to think about the people's involvement with government, not knowing the right people, not knowing how all this works. What's your answer?
How do I solve that? Look, it is hard. Well, there's half a million of us, so it's no wonder it's hard to find the right person to talk to. I mean, the first thing I'd say is this is a new way of working for us as well. So, frankly, some people get it. Some people are still sort of working their way through what it actually means in practice in terms of this sort of partnership of the R&D happening outside of government and then trying to move to scale. So it is, frankly, a work in progress. If you want, I can't sort of give you a list of names, but if you want a tip, I think it's just finding out, frankly, it's all about finding a passion, someone who's got the passion and interest, and it probably isn't always at central government level. Mm-hmm. It's not always going to be based in the Treasury. It's not always going to be based, frankly, in my team, although I've certainly put you in the way of the person who's setting up social impact bonds. I think he's doing a great job in terms of the pilots we're launching this autumn.
Can I push you on that? Yeah. How can we find out about these pilots? What are they? What's going to happen?
Yeah. So we're doing four pilots. Because what I really want to try and do is test. A lot of people talk about social impact bonds, but do they really work in practice? And I really want to poke them and sort of see, because I think there's a lot of good desire behind them, but really want to test it. Four bonds. We're working with four local authorities. Westminster, Hammersmith Fulham, I think it's Birmingham and Leicestershire. The idea being is, can we bring together them as commissioners, private funders, philanthropists potentially, and a third party provider, be it in the private or the public sector, to try and tackle some of the deep embedded problems I was talking about around chaotic families? And can we get a contract structure in place such that if the providers are able to move people to more stabilised lives, we've got to specify what that means. We can actually achieve some specified outcomes to set out in the contract. Then the government will then pay based on those results. Over the next 3 months, we're working our way through with government as a convener to try and see if we can make this happen. I don't know if it will. So we'll have a sort of no-go decision around January. We're going to test that. But that's what I really want to poke. Happily to have separate sessions on that with people in the audience if that will be useful afterwards or bilaterals. But that, I think, is probably the most interesting thing that's happening at the moment. I'd really encourage you to go and speak to good local authorities. And you probably know who they are yourself, but I think that's some of the most interesting work at the moment is happening at local authority level.
There was a sort of related question about the kind of the right role for philanthropy and charities. An old but important question. And it sort of touched on a bit in what you were saying, Richard, about what which kind of things it was appropriate to bring in lifetime legacies for, like universities good, other things not so good.
The US experience, the US experience is that it tends to be great for universities as well as other organisations.
Right. Okay.
There are, for example, even some sort of general relief charities that get benefit from this type of thing. Mm-hmm. It's not exclusive. What I said it's not good for, I don't think, is gifts of works of art. Mm-hmm. Or things. It's great for a way to give shares.
Yeah. On this wider point about where does government end, where does charity begin? I think that was the sort of the drift of the question. Do any of you want to sort of come in on this point? Becky, you look like you're.
I'm wondering. I was thinking about the spectrum between private investment, which is, I think, where you were kind of starting from, the private investment to pure philanthropy and kind of where you draw the lines, which is tricky. And some things do work really well as straightforward investment. You're going to get a good return. You can see that. And it's all about your risk-adjusted return. And then there's stuff over here where mm-hmm. in no world are you ever going to get a return, and that's a grant. And you can kind of, once you start to look at things, you can kind of say, well, okay, well, that's that side. And then there's this whole stuff in the middle around social enterprise, which is fascinating, and there needs to be a lot more of it. And it's doing good, and it may get you a return. It probably will get you your money back. And I think, you know, some people are kind of further up on the profit side, and some people are really, you know, it's about recycling your money mm-hmm. over a 7-year period. You know, so you're putting your cash in, you will get it back, but you might not get anything else. The social impact bonds are much more on the social mission side, mm-hmm. Much less on the financially motivated side. And I think this whole area needs a lot of development, and I think what it needs really is investment. JP Morgan produced a report, Yasmin's not in the room who wrote it, but looking at the areas where impact investment can and does work. And I think it's, we need to be putting cash into those mm-hmm. areas and seeing what happens. I think it's very exciting you're doing the pilots. Mm-hmm. I think there's a whole bunch of things. I've been talking to Diana Barron, who's a friend of ours from the Philanthropy Review, yeah. about, she focuses on domestic abuse and has created this thing called MARACs, which bring together public sector bodies, police, A&E, children's services, substance abuse people, gets them in a room, and they very quickly share information about the problem families they're dealing with. Mm. Cost of a meeting saves the police alone £10,000 in a year. And they have meetings once a fortnight, because what it's allowing the, you know, the police say, well, there's this drunken time waster woman who calls us out regularly. A&E say she's been in with broken limbs twice in the last 3 months. So suddenly you realise there's a problem that needs dealing with. And just the fact that these organisations are sharing information saves money. So that's a private philanthropist creating that intervention, but actually, and kind of leading the way, but actually there's a massive public cost saving. Mm-hmm. And I think those kind of things are where philanthropy and possibly further down the line, social investment can make a huge difference.
Can I just say, I mean, we were talking before this meeting about where we might sort of try and attack each other, like the Russian oligarchs did on television on Saturday night. But I just want to be the Luddite at the table, because I'm a trustee of the Esme Fairbank Foundation. Esme was my great aunt, and so we've always been innovators, and we are the single largest, by some way, investor in social impact bonds. I think there only has been one social impact bond, by the way. I mean, we talk about it as a sort of huge thing. Yeah. There has been one, okay? Secondly, the title of tonight is Changing the Culture of Philanthropy. I fear greatly that the more we talk about social enterprises and social impact bonds, we are going to confuse the hell out of everybody and actually blur the boundaries even more than they are already between government and society. And I believe the culture of philanthropy belongs to society, and responsibility for it lies with society. And we mustn't muddle it with government. We really mustn't. And it's going to become much more complex, this. I mean, I'm confronted by this as a chief executive of a charity, because anyone live in Surrey? Yes. Right, well, Mr. Bottomley, I can tell you that as of, and you probably know this, but as of last night, Richard Branson is now responsible for the provision of all community health care in Surrey. So what do I do about the Marie Curie nurses in Surrey? Where now is government? If I provide Marie Curie nurses in Surrey going forwards, does that enrich Richard Branson so that a new Necker Island house is built based on the donations that people have made to Marie Curie? So life is becoming more complex, and that's why I think it's so critical that we keep these boundaries separate. And there may be wonderful social entrepreneurs and wonderful social enterprises, but I'm sorry, that's not, for me, that's not changing the culture of giving. And we're absolutely stuffed. Going back to that very nice gentleman at the back who was talking about the Institute of Philanthropy, the real problem is we need more money. Not loans, we need more cash to drive the world of charitable enterprise. So I'm sorry to be a pain and a Luddite and a bore, but I got a horrible feeling that I'm right. And I also know that the other person who agrees with me on this, I'm glad to hear he's reacting this way. I know that Ronnie Cohen agrees with me on this. I've heard him say so. Social impact ones are simply not the answer. They are part of the recipe.
Yes.
But it'll be 10 to 20 years before they make an impact. And I'm just worried that people think, well, that's going to be today's answer. It's not. We need money.
No, and I think you're right. And where social investment is going to work, it's going to work in a very narrow field, and it's going to work with large slugs of cash, which is not the way that most giving works at all. You know, so you put money into a social impact fund, you've got to put in $250,000. You can't do any less. It doesn't make sense. The people aren't set up to be able to cope with less. So it's a narrow part of the solution, but I do think it's important to try and say, okay, well, if we can do this and there's cash available, we should grab it.
Okay, it's good.
Can I just make a brief remark, which is, I mean, going back to a couple of points that Tom made, having lived and worked on both sides of the Atlantic, giving to charity in this country is a different experience from giving to charity in the United States. You get your receipt right away. You'll get a really active acknowledgement, and there is a much greater sense that they want to involve you in the charity. And they will tell you all about it, and they will probably, in some cases, suggest that not only you might like to give money, but also volunteer, or give help, or do other things. So, whereas here, if you make a gift to a charity, you're lucky if you get a receipt, and that's going to be a bit later. And so there
Marie
is
Marie Curie will send you a daffodil.
Thank you very much. There's a very blanket statement, and it is overbroad, but there is something. And I know that from my personal experience and from also having seen how charities operate. I know that sitting in the audience, for example, is Joe Rively from the University of Pennsylvania, who's got a lot of experience and seen how the different fundraising techniques work on either side of the Atlantic. But I don't know if...
I'm just conscious we have a lot of questions I can see in the audience. Let's try and take three now, and we'll try and do another. Grab this gentleman in the very back row there who's been waiting very patiently, and two people in the middle, and then there's a couple of others which I've done.
Hi, my name is David Brown. There's a massive difference between philanthropy and charity. And we're looking at the change in the culture of philanthropy rather than just blanket charity as a whole. And one of the differences which was raised was the culture of celebrating this. Mm-hmm. And particularly in the media, if you look at it, every time there's a big donation from a big executive, it's always, does he really deserve to get the money in the first place? Or it's criticism there. Whereas in the US, it's a much more celebration. And it is one big thing to change the culture, is to change the culture of how we celebrate, particularly with the media.
Interesting point.
Yeah.
As you go to the gentleman in the second row and then the lady next to you.
I'm James Kidner, director of Coexist, which is an educational foundation trying to help people understand the role of religion in a globalised society. And I want to ask a question that links that last point with this wider question of government and private charitable sector partnerships. I came to this job, which I've been doing for 5 years, after 20-odd years in the civil service. And I'm struck that the quality of delivery from the charitable sector is not, frankly, always as high as that from government. And so although we, of course, get a warm glow from giving to a charity of our choice, sometimes the delivery competence, our own organization excepted, of course, is not always at the same level. The expense and difficulty of the gift aid procedure is, to my mind, one, it raises a question of whether sometimes actually taxation isn't an effective way of giving too.
Mm-hmm. Teresa Lloyd, I was the founder director of Philanthropy UK and the author of Why Rich People Give, and I'm a trustee of the European Association for Philanthropy and Giving with Richard and others. Well, a number of points, but given the time scale, I think the one I would make is that all the points about making it easier for people to give, the lifetime legacies, which I strongly support, and payroll giving and all the rest of it, are hugely important. But people don't just give, as your own research and my research and everybody's research shows, they give to a cause. They give because mm-hmm. they care yeah. passionately, yeah. they give because they've been inspired, and they give because they want to make a difference. And ideally, notwithstanding what's been just said, their behaviour, if you like, is reinforced because they see that they have made a difference and what their money can achieve. So mechanisms are needed, but they can only go so far. And as Rebecca pointed out, only, I think you said, 17% of your clients are giving. These are very high net worth individuals. Why is that? It's not because they haven't been told about payroll giving. It is because they haven't been inspired, they mm-hmm. haven't been shown how they can make a difference, and they don't understand what they could achieve. And as Tom says, they also haven't discovered what fun it is. And of course, until you start, you don't discover. And I think, although there seems to be a resistance about talking about developing a culture of asking, I'm going to talk about it for a second, mm-hmm. which is that a culture of philanthropy and enhancing it does depend on that inspiration and so on. And I think one of the major differences, we've talked about it several times already, today between the US and the UK, and one of them is the importance of the understanding by organizations raising money of the involvement of trustees, of the involvement of chief executives, and Tom was exemplary in this. It is not, at this level, a job to just hand over to a possibly not very highly paid fundraiser. Fundraisers, are, I mean, even one myself, wonderful people, but in the end, it's an institutional commitment and understanding about encouraging what the donors will see as investment, as a long-term relationship, and so on. And it is about the involvement of the whole institution, not just the organization.
Very good. Now, let's try and take some answers to those questions, and we'll come back for our last round of questions. Who wants to jump
on? Can I just take on the very first point you made? Because I really react strongly against it, actually. I think it's a terrible mistake to advocate sort of competition on performance between government and the voluntary sector. And I hope you don't mind being so frank with you, but I as a trustee of Esme Fairbairn, I see and witness at first hand, and we fund with £25 million a year, organisations that deliver care, support and education as efficiently as government. Not more efficiently, not less efficiently. As efficiently, but almost always at lower cost. So please be really careful about making statements like that. You may have had some bad experiences, but my God, there are some fantastic organisations delivering care to very vulnerable people. I just wanted to say that. And I think we should always celebrate partnership with government, and government should always celebrate partnership with the voluntary sector. That's the way to do it, in my view. Sorry, I just wanted to make that point.
Robin, you wanted to?
Yeah, I wanted to pick up on the point about recognition and the media, and actually link it to a point that Theresa made about giving should be fun, because I do think that, and I mentioned this at the beginning, that if one is trying to change the culture, one of the things that we need to get better is actually celebrating people who give, particularly at a local level, particularly at a community level, but equally at some of these major levels. And if you give and then you get criticised in the media, it is not fun. And I think this is an issue. I think it's part of, it was, I did mention media in saying where are the areas that we've got to consider in trying to change the culture. And I would like to think that one day there will be philanthropy correspondents who will look at what's going on in a different kind of way. I don't know whether that's a possibility. But coming back to giving ought to be fun, I just want to make a point, the obvious point on lifetime legacies. It gives you a chance to get involved in a particular way with a charity. If you're dead, it's not much fun.
Yes. That's very important,
as far as we know.
Can I say something else on lifetime legacies, which I wanted to say millions of times while you were speaking? It's Teresa's point. 65 to 70% of endowments in arts institutions and in universities are made up of lifetime legacies. If we are
in the United States,
therefore, if we are saying as a country that what we want is universities with endowments and arts institutions with endowments, and we seem to be saying that quite a lot on a governmental level, then I think there's something about the government saying, okay, well, how do we do this? And the way to do it is lifetime legacies.
We have an absolute forest of hands and about 5 minutes left on a nightmare situation. Gentlemen here has been incredibly patient, as Peter, and then we'll try and pick off a couple of others. If we ask short questions, we'll try and take a bit of a blizzard of questions.
Thank you. Graham Allen, Member of Parliament and author of two reports for HMG this year on early intervention and attempting now to establish an early intervention foundation. Give the panel a chance to come back to the title of the talk tonight, changing the culture of philanthropy rather than the culture of giving. The culture of philanthropy from the outside looks as though it's fun, it's one-off, it's edgy, all the things that the panel have said tonight. But I think there's something new to the party. which is evidence-based programs and evidence-based policymaking. Mm-hmm. And I think that may well have a serious impact on the culture of philanthropy if people can bring themselves to swallow it. And the reason I say that is what is going to be ever more important in an era of public expenditure reduction is that replication and taking things to scale, which may be boring, may not be much fun, may not be very edgy, but things that work will, in my opinion, benefit immensely if philanthropy comes to the party. And I'm thinking of things like the Family Nurse Partnership, which is a tremendous evidence base for active involvement of health visitors with teen mums, the Family Intervention Projects, etc. There are dozens that we could mention. And I'd like the panel to consider whether, in fact, the advent of properly evidence-based programmes could be the biggest change for the culture of philanthropy that we've seen.
Very, very interesting point. Can we hold on before answering that 1 second? Try and take Pete's question right at the front here in the corner. Been lurking for ages.
Can I offer one or two thoughts, not all connected? Arts and lifetime legacies. In the West of the United States 28 years ago, I saw a man who was quite elderly give his art collection, and the town's dentist said they'd give him $30,000 a year, which he wanted for a living, and the town's doctor said they'd provide his medical costs. So he was able to give his art, aged about 80, and the rest of his life was secure. So it's a slight reverse of the idea which you've had. Philanthropy isn't just money. I was never very good at Greek, but I don't think it's built into the word. So if you start saying, what can people do from early age, if you put it in the context of giving blood, the gift relationship, which Daisy was taught, is useful. If you start thinking of the people who get help and then go on to become junior instructors, whether it's scouts or the boys' brigade or sailing or other things, it's the giving. It's the involvement and the giving which works. And then just coming on to money towards the end, just two or three ideas, none of which are particularly new. One is, when you can afford it, to say to children or grandchildren, I'm giving away some money this year, will you help me decide where it goes, which gets the involvement even when they haven't got the cash. Another is to do what my mother did, which is to say, I have four surviving children, I'm going to give the money to five, and the family can decide who gets the fifth. And what I plan to do for our children and grandchildren is say, we're going to leave you more than you actually need, and I want you to decide how to give away the rest. And remember the last big foundation thing, John MacArthur gave away nearly $1 billion, and he said to his trustees, you decide what it goes on. So the idea that the good cause matters to everyone isn't quite right.
No. Mm-hmm.
And we're going to take one last question. There's a lady right in the middle there in a white suit. We do have, I would encourage you all to stay afterwards and linger. I know there's lots of unanswered questions and unasked questions, in fact. But we will be able to continue the conversation after we finish.
Hi, Kate Murphy, JP Morgan. I have an entrepreneurial business and I head up the family and entrepreneurial business for the private bank. Just to come back to this gentleman's point here, I think a valid point that we are talking about philanthropy, but should we really be separating philanthropy from giving? Because obviously people potentially only become philanthropic if they have had parents, etc., encouraging them to give from a very early stage. So as a consequence of that, should we not be pulling the two together? Secondly, covering family businesses, I've had incredible experiences of seeing family businesses be very, very philanthropic. On top of that, I've had great experiences of seeing their businesses be very good at giving and their staff being particularly good at giving because, as the gentleman at the front said, it is true that if you're engaged and you engage your staff, it makes a huge difference in terms of them giving. Mm-hmm. Third point, in terms of entrepreneurs, etc., from my experience from that point of view, can we not encourage entrepreneurs either from a tax perspective or from some other way? My business was given a grant. We don't have to pay that grant back if we become billionaires. That seems crazy. We did talk to the government about that. Could we, in some way, obviously we can just give that from a philanthropic point of view, but if entrepreneurs were encouraged, if they are successful, to then pass that on and given some incentive to do that to a charity, then it's an easy way for the government to get additional money for charities. And the last point was basically, I've forgotten.
we have panelists, I think bursting to answer as well. I'm going to actually start with Rebecca, because you seem so keen to come in on this point, particularly about the evidence base.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's a no-brainer, isn't it? So you give people evidence that what they give to works, and they will give more. I mean, the more we can do that. Yeah. That's why the impact bonds are actually quite interesting, because you have to show the evidence. Yeah. So as a tool, they work quite well, but anything around early intervention where you can show evidence, I think it's very attractive to donors.
Gareth, so you're pricking up your ears.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think this idea of sort of trying to measure social impact as well as some of the financial impacts is really important. Look, I reckon, Thomas, coming back to your earlier point around do we want to blood mix the waters, muddy the waters here. I think it's, from government, it's a really interesting role here. It's not our role to sort of corral or direct. It's something about broadening the options for philanthropy, and that's where I see the role of social finance. I don't think it's an either or; it's a both and there. Mm. I think the institution is the evidence-based institution, really important idea. I think it's got a real potential to really transform, frankly, not just philanthropy, but actually the way in which government does business. Because, as I said, in my opening comments, philanthropy is very important, but frankly, public spending is still half of national income. Mm. So if we can get that spent more effectively, we can then that also helps philanthropic spend.
Very good. There were some other interesting questions in there about particularly this point about the culture. And the
ability. Well, I was going to pick up the point on family businesses. I think that philanthropy can play a hugely important part in that delicate process of succession planning.
Yes.
How you hand on to a new generation a business or a thriving organisation, a family organisation. And I think philanthropy, you can often talk to different generations about philanthropy where there may be difficulties about deciding on the business structure or something. I mean,
absolutely, yes, I've seen that. We've seen that with client situations in a number of cases where there is an absolute sort of barrier of one generation talking to another. But if you open it up to get them engaged in some common philanthropic endeavour, they'll talk and then you increase the engagement very powerfully.
And I love Peter's ideas because I think at the end of the day, unless we get to the situation where the mass affluent, I'm sorry to use that phrase, but that's where the prize lies. It's not in the very rich. They're already, most of them, very generous. And it's not in people who have less, because they give so much more than everybody else.
Yes.
So the real prize is that the person who is earning £60,000 a year sees it as being like planning a holiday, that they allocate a percentage of their income, just as they do to a holiday, to giving. And unless we do that, this all will fail. That's my view.
There you have it. That's quite a note to end on. I'm afraid we are, unfortunately, out of time. The audience, you've all asked brilliant questions. We've got such experts in the room. I hope you will hang around and do continue the conversation. But Robin, Richard, Rebecca, Gareth and Tom, thank you so much for your brilliant answers. Thank you.